Henry VIII's marriage to Anne Boleyn was declared invalid by Pope Clement VII in March 1534. Henry responded by declaring that the Pope's authority in England had been revoked. The Act of Supremacy was passed by Parliament in November of that year. The title Supreme Head of the Church of England was now bestowed upon Henry as a result of this event. In addition, a Treason Act was passed that made it illegal to accuse the King and his heirs of heresy or tyranny by any means, including writing and speaking, and all subjects were required to swear an oath of allegiance. In April 1535, the Priors of the Carthusian Houses, Axholme Priory in North Lincolnshire and Beauvale Priory in Nottinghamshire refused to recognise the King as the Church of England's head. This is the account of their final days. It would be wonderful if you could subscribe and support the channel. Just hit the bell icon to select all notifications so you never miss any of our videos. And with that said, let's continue today's story. Cromwell had been discussing what to do with King Henry after a recent examination of holy prisoners. On the 27th of April, an order was sent to the Tower that these men would face trial the following day. Amongst the prisoners was Richard Reynolds, a Brigittine monk from Syon Abbey, which was founded in 1415 and stood until its demolition in the 16th century. The men were charged with treacherously machinating and desiring the King of his title as Supreme Head of the Church of England. They all pleaded not guilty to the charge of treason, answering as one that they would do nothing against the laws of God or the Catholic Church. Cromwell, who visited the men, asked everyone to renounce the Pope's authority and confess he had fraudulently and violently, by extortion, given away his importance. They were also told to abandon all foreign power, jurisdiction and obedience to any person or order. The only man they should now look up to for guidance in spiritual and earthly matters was the King himself. Cromwell insisted that he would accept nothing more than an absolute agreement to what he said. He continued by saying he had no care for the church, so will you consent or not? But the men held firm in their beliefs. Each answered they dare not go against God and their opinions, and they would never betray or forsake the Catholic Church. The men were once again confined to their cells. Reynolds would succumb to an additional charge of attempting to dissuade people from submitting to the King's authority. One witness came forward and claimed that Reynolds had stated that the Dowager Princess, Queen Catherine, was the true Queen. However, Reynolds denied that he had declared an opinion against the King, accepting confession. This was quite possibly the final nail in his coffin. The five accused were all found guilty, although the jury spent almost a day coming to their decisions. However, the length of time to convict them played on Cromwell's mind, and he sent word to find out why the delay. His question was not taken well. The jurors had found it difficult to pass such a sentence on holy men, saying they felt each man was innocent and free from any unlawful crime. Cromwell reported the findings to Henry, who sent back the following message in an uncontrollable rage. Unless you find them guilty, you yourselves will suffer death as having transgressed the law. But the jurors held firm and continued to refuse compliance with Henry's wishes. Henry stood back no longer. He went himself and urged them to find a verdict, whether by lying or not. They must be declared guilty of high treason. It was accepted, yet the jurors stated that their conscience proved they did not do it with any malice after the event, but they would not show their faces again, ashamed of the act they had been brutally forced into taking. Thursday, 29th of April, the five accused were brought back into court. Reynolds would be questioned first by Audley. Why do you alone persist in the opinion against an act of Parliament? Reynolds replied, our belief has far greater weight and abundant testimony than yours, for you have the few of Parliament on your side, whereas I have the whole Christian world on mine. Reynolds' tirade offended many listening, and Cromwell had heard enough. Reynolds was now ordered to speak no more. But the court case was a sham. The jury knew what had to be said, and the rest of the talk was just a prelude to the inevitable, and the men were now sent back to the Tower in preparation for their executions. Cranmer suggested to the King that his purpose might be better served if he gave them a few days to think about their refusal. Henry thought about this and then confirmed they would have until the 4th of May. Although all seemed lost, Cromwell would send Thomas Starkey, a once chaplain to Margaret Beaufort, and now one of the king's chaplains, in the hope he may convert the men's thoughts and avoid a painful death. Starkey said he had spoken with Reynolds but could not get anything from him that could inspire hope. Reynolds was said to have continued his same line of thought, one that, in his opinion, would make him a disobedient man to the king and his laws, but he could not bring himself to admonish Henry, who he thought was blind and had a superstitious opinion. Dawn broke on the 4th of May. The five men would be taken from their cells and led to the Tower Gate. One witness said they did not grow pale, their voices remained given a clarity whilst objecting to the king, but remaining obedient to the church. They all smiled as if filled with the Holy Ghost, then one by one laid themselves on the hurdle and would start their final journey to Tyburn. Thomas More was also imprisoned and was speaking with his daughter. The sound of horses' hooves drew him to the window. He turned to his daughter and said, "Do you not see, Meg, these blessed fathers so cheerful now going to their deaths as bridegrooms to a marriage?" The journey from the tower to Tyburn was 3 miles. It was a painful trip as the hurdle jolted over the stones and splashed through puddles and mud. There was a large crowd, not just at the scene but en route, but the majority were quiet and sullen with feelings of doubt, and it wouldn't be long before the tree was in sight, the fire, the cart, and the usual trappings of a horrible place. The court of Henry was out in strength, including the privy chamber. All stood close to where the men would die. It's been said Henry himself would have attended to see the butchery. The presence of the courtiers had one objective: to stop anyone else disapproving of his mandate and to spread fear and potentially cease any thought of an uprising. The five men condemned climbed the scaffold, each given one last opportunity to recant, but all refused. A brief speech by the men was their last words. Reynolds was the last man. He was strung up and half strangled with a very thick cord, then kicked from the ladder to swing, almost immediately cut down and dragged to a plank, and then hurriedly stripped, the body sliced open with entrails and heart thrown into a fire. The remainder of the body was quartered, with each part fixed in various parts of the city. Despite their strict enclosure, the monks of the London Charterhouse were held in high esteem and had considerable influence among the people, as many used to consult the Carthusians for spiritual advice. But in the eyes of many religious figures, the battle for now was over. It would be martyrdom that would fall upon these men in the years to come. One Protestant author wrote, "There is no cause in which a man can more nobly suffer than to witness that it's better for him to die than to speak the words he does not mean." Yet these five men wouldn't be the last. Between 1535 and 1679, a total of 359 men and women were executed due to their beliefs for treason and other laws enacted by Parliament. All but 6 of the 40 who went on to become martyrs had been hanged, drawn, and quartered. Richard Reynolds was beatified in 1886 and canonized by Pope Paul VI in 1970 as one of the 40 martyrs of England and Wales. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed the story, please leave a comment and don't forget to like the video and of course subscribe. And we'll see you again soon.